Hello, and welcome to On Air with Akin Gump. I'm your host, Jose Garriga. Whether you've not been able to go to the movies, or have spent the last 5 months diving deep into Netflix, HBO Max, and Disney Plus, COVID-19 has had an impact on the way you consume entertainment. And it has had an even greater impact on the industry that produces films and television programs, upending production and release schedules, and fostering the growth of new platforms even as it pulls the rug out from under others. We have with us today Akin Gump Entertainment Practice Head Chris Spicer and partner Alissa Miller. They'll be speaking about the impact the pandemic has had on production, financing, and other aspects of the entertainment industry, and how it affects what and where you'll be enjoying your next movie. Welcome to the podcast. Chris, Alissa, thank you both for appearing on the show today. This is a big topic, so let's dive right in. To start, COVID has unprecedentedly affected many sectors of the economy, the entertainment industry, of course, among them. So let me start by asking, what has the big picture impact been? Chris, if you would.
Yeah, of course. And thanks for having us on the show, and happy to be here. So, I mean, it's a broad question, right? The decimation of, you know, various sectors in the entertainment industry has been no exception and has in many ways been hit harder than most. I would like to start on a more positive front when we have these conversations before kind of diving into all of the effects of the capital inflows and shutdowns of various different companies that are, you know, in the business of delivering entertainment to people. First off, when we frame this conversation, right, we're talking about kind of the investment in content generally, and that's kind of what we'll speak about today, and Alissa and I will both speak about more of the specifics in that regard. But separately, it's been a kind of an effect on, you know, broader segment when we call kind of traditional entertainment everything from live events to, you know, as you mentioned in your intro, kind of being able to go to the movies. You know, as I said, on the positive front, you know, what we've noticed in the various clients and industry colleagues that we've been working with for the last 5 to 6 months now in trying to get production started and kind of figure out various ways to kind of produce the content that, you know, employs many people in our country and in other countries and kind of delivers the content to various people to view. There's been a lot of creativity and a lot of new ways of trying to kind of experience and trying to figure out, you know, both how to give people content that's already existing and how people view that and consume that, whether that's in their home, on their mobile device, or, you know, through a drive-through theater. And then additionally, in terms of kind of how the production of content has been happening for the last 6 months, there has been a tremendous amount of creativity from, you know, changing the way that films or television programs are shot to kind of introducing protocols for safety and keeping all of the various people on kind of sets for films and television shows, which can really be like small, you know, small communities or even towns, you know, but at the same time allowing people to come back to work. So that piece of this has been pretty tremendous to see. On that note, so kind of big picture, what's happened is, you know, anyone that's read the news, you know, kind of knows a lot of this, right? Virtually every live event venue has been shut down, from sports to concerts to film to, you know, you name it, you can't go do that anymore. And that's had a broad kind of sweeping impact on the entertainment industry and kind of what we do day to day. And it's also kind of accelerated the already pre-existing massive shift to in-home viewing, whether that's of stuff that traditionally people, you know, viewed in-home, like kind of episodes of 30-minute comedy series, to, you know, huge, what used to be or kind of still are, large live kind of event-type films or television shows. And that's sort of shifted all kind of in-house. Obviously, another thing that COVID's done is it's shut down the production of film and television and digital projects worldwide, you know, at least temporarily. And different countries, which we'll get into, I think, later in our talk, have kind of had mixed success getting productions back and going in a safe environment. So that's all kind of what has happened. That's led to liquidity crunches for large, you know, many companies that produce content for people, both kind of on a massive scale. So, you know, traditional major studios like such as Disney to, you know, lower, you know, all the way down to kind of 2 or 3 person independent production companies that, you know, produce 1 or 2 films a year and kind of everyone that is kind of in between. And that's sort of the current state of where we are from the onset of the COVID epidemic, both in the United States and globally.
Thank you. So let's look at the working level a bit. You provided the big picture. Looking then at on the project level, what impact has a pandemic had on projects that are halfway to completion, and then stepping it back on the financing of traditional entertainment projects? Alissa, if you would, please.
Sure. So let's go back to March. Basically, globally, every production shut down. Complete halt, and cast and crew were basically furloughed. Productions had to completely shut down with the lockdown. And there was definitely a lot of uncertainty as to when those productions could resume. But the good thing was during that time, producers really had to dig in to figure out what kind of precautions they were going to take once productions could resume. So they spent a lot of time working on those protocols with the guilds and with other production companies and with local and federal organizations so that they were actually prepared for once production could resume. And we've seen probably in the last month, a lot of productions have been able to resume. And the good news was they were ready and they had everything in place so that production could really resume on a meaningful level, just talking about productions that had already started pre-COVID. I'm not talking about new productions right now. Those productions had adequate insurance in place pre-COVID that they were able to move forward with productions once again. I would say, depending on what kind of production it was, as far as when they could resume and how long it was going to take. For example, if you had a production that had a lot of dialogue and not a lot of action, that didn't require a lot of extras to be on set, that was certainly much easier to resume production on and finish because they didn't need to have, you know, so many people on set. Having 20 people on set is a lot different than having 100. So it just really depended on the type of project that it was. Many have resumed, some have not. However, the budget that producers were having to work with at inception, say it was a $10 million production, all those extra protocols and PPE and testing, all of that has really added on to the budget. So that was unexpected for producers, and they've had to come up with ways to cover that extra budget. All producers do have what they call a contingency in the budget that does cover unexpected amounts, probably not enough to cover the unexpected COVID costs, just because those extra costs are not just PPE and testing, but having kind of like a hall monitor on set that is making sure everybody's standing 6 feet apart. A shoot that normally would be 10 days might be 20 now because you can't have everybody on set at the same time. So really kind of exorbitant costs that they wouldn't have known at the outset. But I would say for the most part, the good news is that producers were really ready to go. They were ready to go in July, and several of our clients and producers that we know were able to resume at that time. Getting into kind of the second part of your question on financing of traditional entertainment projects. So going into new projects, that's really where the issues have arisen. We'll get further into it in the next few questions, but basically the big difference post-COVID is that producers require insurance policies to be in place that cover things, without getting into too many specifics, cover things like delays in production due to things like COVID, and also cover if an actor gets sick or injured from COVID, and anything else, breaking their leg, anything like that going forward. And financiers and investors in the film project want an insurance policy in order to give financing. Post-COVID, insurers are excluding all claims related to COVID. So you have gotten into this issue of there's an exclusion in the insurance policy. So financiers are trying to have to figure out other ways to finance the project the way that they traditionally have been because there just is not insurance for it. So the result at first, when we were kind of looking at this, you know, the result was, you know, nothing can go forward. Some financiers and producers have been able to figure out costly ways around it, such as maybe there's a parent guarantee where the producer's ultimate parent is having to cover any of those costs related to COVID that the insurance policy does not cover. So it's really, and you know, financiers are having to look at other ways to cover off those costs and the potential for another lockdown. I think people are equally as concerned with, is there going to be another lockdown, or is our lead actor going to get sick and production is going to have to shut down for a month? And the way that productions work is the distributor that's going to buy the production, they, you know, if Brad Pitt is the person that's supposed to play the lead role, if he gets sick and is out and has to be replaced, the distributor doesn't want the project anymore. I mean, they bought a Brad Pitt project. They didn't buy a Chris Spicer project. So, you know, that's something that people are having. That's something that we're having to deal with. And another thing is, we thought that it's not just an issue of having the COVID exclusion on insurance. It is definitely getting excluded from the normal insurance policies. I don't think we all anticipated that the cost of insurance, even with a COVID exclusion, would go up. But because insurers have just across the board had to have, you know, payouts related to COVID, not even necessarily related to entertainment, insurance policies are, you know, those costs have increased. So that's just yet another thing that producers are having to deal with as they move forward in their financing. It's just another extra cost. So, you know, people understand from the insurance company's point of view, they're just taking the position that COVID is an uninsurable event. So we're just trying to come up with ways to cover that off without putting the insurance company in a worse place, but in order to make the producer and the financier whole.
Interesting.
Yeah, Jose, and just stepping back on that, just we've kind of tried to work with both kind of producers of content who are our clients, as well as people in the, you know, capital stack of a lot of these projects and companies. You know, everyone just wants certainty, right? So when a senior financier at a, you know, financial institution that's a, you know, large, you know, commercial financial bank wants to invest in a project, they want a certain level, you know, of knowing that if kind of they're willing to take risk A, B, and C, but not, you know, D through Z. And so at some of the projects that we've been helping to set up, many of which have gone into production, the producers, who are kind of the primary people responsible for organizing the, you know, financing of a film, whether that's a billionaire financing it, the whole thing, or seven different capital sources, you know, what's happened is anyone who's willing to kind of take on the COVID risk, whether that's kind of not covered by insurance or anything else, is going to be compensated for taking that risk. So that's kind of where there's an opportunity for certain funds or equity investors on particular films and particular television shows that, you know, during the physical production of the film, like meaning when actors and actresses are on set behind camera, and they get compensated really, really well for that risk. And that's an opportunity for those individuals, and it does cost the producer a higher premium to kind of get the money to do that filming. And then the gamble that they're making, which I think we'll get into kind of what we're going to talk about later on in the podcast, is the demand for content has increased, you know, I mean, maybe not quite exponentially, but close to exponentially, in a time when the ability to produce content has decreased exponentially. So the producers and the projects who we're working with, kind of their bet is, look, we're okay paying our, you know, higher cost of capital right now to get, you know, this show moving or this film done. We've kind of minimized the amount of time we need to be on set behind camera. We've, you know, set up safety protocols, and we know that's going to cost us more, but they're hoping when they have a finished film or finished miniseries or whatever it may be, that that's going to be more valuable than it otherwise would have been and make up for the cost of kind of the extra cost that it was, that it took to produce the show.
Thank you. So one thing that I wanted to follow up on is something that Chris had mentioned, which was U.S. and overseas entertainment industries. And Alissa, let me ask you this. To what extent are these two industries faring differently? Are overseas companies closer to resuming their accustomed production schedules? And going back to the idea of financing and investment, how is this affecting the flow globally of financing and investment monies if, say, overseas industries are opening more quickly than those here in the United States?
Right. So that's a really good question. At the onset of the lockdown, pretty much all countries were in the same position. But as we've seen, you know, Europe had a much more stringent lockdown than we had in the U.S., as did Asia and Australia, New Zealand. Their numbers got to a better place. You know, they were really bad in the beginning, worse than the U.S., but as we all know, they got much better, and now they're spiking on and off. However, a lot of those countries were in a position, especially Asia, Australia, New Zealand, to resume production probably a bit quicker than was able to be done in the U.S. However, the U.S. is the biggest production hub in the world, so their level of production is much smaller than ours. I would say, though, the government, some European countries and Canada, Australia, New Zealand, realized this insurance issue, the same issue in those countries as in the U.S., and the governments there have provided some vehicles for coverage, basically government backstops where the government, once certain requirements are met, are paying out to producers for new productions some of the losses that would have been covered by traditional insurance. And the UK is the most significant one. I think the program is at about $650 million. And to the extent, you know, something resumes production and there's a loss that insurance wouldn't cover, the government basically acts as a backstop and pays out a certain amount. But it's, you know, it's capped at a not particularly high amount. And productions in the UK, which is probably the second largest after the US, are most of the time, much lower budgets than we have in the US. So, you know, this is something that when we start talking about the American Coalition for Independent Content Production in a bit, we can talk about it because we are proposing a similar program in the U.S. But going back to it, productions were able to take advantage of some of those programs. You know, older productions that had been halted during COVID, I think we could say, went back quicker in Australia, New Zealand, even Canada, some places in Europe and in Asia, but it's such a small fraction of the amount that we've seen in the U.S., so I'd say it's a bit easier. You know, a lot of those countries where shooting occurs, it's much more spread out than a lot of the places in the U.S., like in California, Los Angeles, New York, Georgia, Louisiana. So I think they were able to basically have a more meaningful production without having so many concerns. There is a concern in the U.S. about producers moving overseas because it's just easier. There's a lot of regulations in the U.S., but like, as I said before, producers have basically gone above and beyond all the, you know, the regulations and protocols that are required. The guilds here, SAG, WGA, DGA, are very strict in what's required. And instead of kind of fighting any of those regulations and protocols, like producers here are going above and beyond.
Thank you. A reminder, listeners, we're here today with Akin Gump Entertainment Partners, Chris Spicer and Alissa Miller, discussing the impact of COVID-19 on the entertainment industry. Something that we've mentioned, alluded to earlier in this episode has been streaming services. And one of the few segments of the industry, at least from the man on the street's perspective, that have perhaps been helped by the pandemic has been the streamers. So to what extent have the streaming services received a boost from so many people at home binging shows? And is this growth sustainable? Chris, what do you think?
So that's a great question. And right, you know, one only needs to look at kind of the stock price of Facebook and Apple and Netflix and Google and sort of see a common denominator of, you know, the all-time highs that seem to be happening every day, despite the fact that we're in a global pandemic. And for differing and varying reasons, a large part of that is due to, you know, the consumption of consumers at home and the increased viewership. So what we've noticed, and again, this is nothing kind of anyone that follows the industry closely, this is no kind of surprise or secret or nothing earth shattering, but you know, there's a type of movie that gets released in theaters, and you know, everyone kind of wants to see the Avengers in a movie theater. And then there's been a, you know, shift both in terms of the technology that allows kind of excellent viewership from home to, you know, younger generations wanting to view content on iPads and phones and watches as opposed to kind of sitting in a movie theater to view it. So that shift has been happening over the last 5 years, and there's been now a, you know, obvious huge kind of push in that direction for, you know, something that was kind of happening in any event. And then in terms of, you know, so if kind of insiders in the industry talk about an arms race for content, and then what's happened is, and it's almost to the point where it's been overwhelming for the consumers, you know, previously, you know, it started with Netflix, and then, you know, now there's probably about a dozen different, you know, over-the-top streaming services to choose from, to the point where cord cutting, which is a kind of term that I think is in everyone's vernacular now, it used to kind of be, oh, you know, I'm saving costs by cord cutting, and all I really need is, you know, I have Netflix and Hulu, and then I, whatever, get Major League Baseball on demand because I'm a baseball fanatic. And it's gotten to the point where, you know, the cord cutting, and now it's kind of more expensive if you need to have kind of all 12 or so streaming services, to where you're having to pick and choose what streaming service you kind of want to sign up for. You know, so I think that we talk about there will end up being winners and losers in that kind of war for kind of eyeballs, and kind of the growth being sustainable is, you know, I think that no one thinks that in-home viewing and streaming is going to go away. My personal view is that kind of the most stark example that we've seen, and Alissa can bring up another one if is kind of Mulan, which is kind of one of these huge, you know, multiple hundreds of millions of dollar budgeted movies for Disney. The live action remake is now going on to Disney Plus streaming as opposed to being in the theater. And if that really represents a seismic shift away from kind of big budget tentpole films going to the theater or not, my personal view is, you know, people are still going to want to go to theaters for that type of movie. And the reasoning that one is, again, is sort of happenstance that Mulan's going straight to Disney Plus. But, mm-hmm. you know, the growth, it's hard, right? Because Netflix's growth was very, very prolific in the U.S. And now kind of most of their growth, and for a long time, their stock price and what happened was dependent on their international growth. So I think that, you know, and again, Netflix right now primarily is people pay a monthly price for their service, right? Amazon's who kind of we also, you know, we work a lot with on the other side of kind of content deals, that, you know, their goals aren't kind of exactly the same as Netflix, and, you know, Disney's goals are slightly different, and kind of all of them are. And you can see that in Apple Plus streaming service. They priced it so that, you know, low enough that it's not really kind of really that much out of pocket for someone, but then also kind of as long as you keep buying Apple products, you'll kind of keep getting their streaming service for free. So just extra incentive to maintain yourself in the Apple ecosystem. But, you know, the one thing it has done for producers of content, and, you know, it's changed the way productions are made. It's changed the way the economics are looking at it, but there is a massively increased demand for content, and for companies that we work with who've been able to creatively figure out how to get their films and shows finished during COVID have kind of been an incredible advantage. I mean, we have one client that, you know, had something that kind of they thought they were going to be able to sell the particular product for kind of X when they finished it, and we're fortunate enough to only have 3 days of shooting left when kind of COVID shut down the world, and we're able to kind of do a little bit of the fudging around from stuff in post-production, which kind of for non-insiders is just kind of the period of time where you're not actually filming actors behind camera, but in a back bay room kind of editing footage, and had kind of one more day of reshoot with someone they were able to do so. And they ended up being able to sell it to a streamer for kind of a multiplier of what they thought they were going to sell it for. So, you know, that's the real opportunity for producers of content. Alissa, would love to, if you have any kind of similar or different experiences from mine.
I do not have any different experiences. I think that's definitely, I'm right on the same page with you. I think there hopefully won't be a lack of content in the future. I mean, there's going to be so many productions that should have been finished this year that now will not. So there may be a bit of a lack of content in 2021, but hopefully you know, there's so much out there that it catches up, but I don't think it will have a significant impact on the streaming services.
Thank you. Alissa, let me stay with you just to follow up on something that you mentioned earlier, which is the American Coalition for Independent Content Production. You spearheaded this organization's creation. What can you tell us about the ACICP's aims and work?
Sure. So the ACICP came up and came together probably, I think it was in May. And after the shutdown and halt on production, and we started talking to our clients and our clients' clients and realized that there were going to be significant issues, not only really with new productions. So putting aside ones that had already started and were on hiatus. And there were several issues that we were focused on, but really the insurance issue is probably what's become the biggest one. So we started talking to, as I said, our clients and our clients' clients to try to figure out what we could do, we meaning Akin Gump, between our entertainment group and our policy group in DC, to try to lobby for protections and benefits for production companies to get production back going and get cast and crew and all the industries that production, entertainment productions employ, up to speed and rehired. Because if you think about it, it's not just the actors and the cameraman and the executives and employees of the production companies that were being affected. It's also really every other industry related to production, whether it's hospitality, hotels, restaurants, you know, lighting companies, accounting firms. I mean, it really has such a significant impact. The entertainment industry provides about $180 billion in revenues in the U.S. on a normal year. So we started talking with our different groups that were involved in production, not just producers, but distributors, sales agents, bond companies, even some financiers, and we put together a group of about 35 right now, you know, different people in the independent content production space to lobby for different, I'll talk about what we're pushing right now in DC. And just to be clear, these are really independent producers. It's not the major studios like Universal, Paramount, Disney, Fox, or Disney and Fox are combined, but we don't really target those because those are, even though those companies have had significant issues with COVID, they're part of large media conglomerates that generally have more cash on hand, so we're less affected. They don't usually rely on production financing like independent producers do. We are now focused on, I would say, three main initiatives in Washington. And the biggest one is related to the insurance issue that I described before. And we're trying to, you know, lobby the government, DC, not, you know, on a federal level, not state level at this point, to provide a backstop, similar to what has happened in the UK and France and Australia and other countries, where to the extent that the producer has a loss related to COVID that is excluded from their insurance policy, the government would pay out a certain amount on a production related to that loss. That is the most meaningful thing to the members of the group because it's what is preventing them from going back to production in a meaningful way. So we're working on that. And then the second part of the equation is figuring out if we can push for federal incentives, tax incentives that cover off some of these content producers' increased costs related to COVID. So it could be, you know, providing coverage for all those extra COVID costs, like we described before, PPE and testing. This is not unique to just the production world. You know, every other industry has those same costs and expenses. So there are several initiatives that are being discussed in DC right now. We just want to make sure that the group, our lobbyists, push for those incentives and make sure that they'll apply to the production industry, because most of the items that are being proposed, whether it's a payroll tax credit or COVID-related coverage related to employees, are for W-2 employees. And in the production industry, a lot of the cast and crew, it just depends. They're not always treated as independent contractors. Sometimes they are, sometimes they aren't. but we want to make sure that cast and crew are covered. And that's, we're also talking about some things related to PPP loans, because a lot of our members of the coalition and entertainment space generally weren't able to apply for them, the PPP loans, because of the affiliation requirements. So that's something that we're looking into as well. But again, the most important thing for the members of this coalition is figuring out a way around the insurance issue. We've had several meetings with both Democrat and Republican Hill members, and you know, we're just pushing forward and trying to figure out something that will bridge the gap. We're not. Yeah, go ahead, Chris.
Akin Gump is uniquely suited on kind of for the ties between kind of the entertainment media industry in Hollywood and Washington, D.C. So as a law firm, we are uniquely suited to navigate this particular situation in this context.
Yeah, that's a good point. Pulling back a bit from this, and thank you, Alissa, that sounds like the ACICP is doing terrific work in this space. To wrap up, you know, we've covered a lot of ground. For listeners, people in sectors outside of the entertainment industry, what should they expect in terms of the near and midterm prospects for companies in entertainment and media that we've been discussing? Chris, if you would, please.
Yeah, of course. We'll look for the average viewer, just kind of looking at the entertainment and media industry. I mean, I would expect for the at least not too distant future to get most of your premium viewing from a streamer in the comfort of your own home. Although, you know, personally, I myself am looking forward to seeing the Christopher Nolan movie Tenet in the theaters whenever I'm able to. And in terms of the near and midterm prospects, again, since we are primarily involved in the, you know, financing and investment in content and companies that are in the entertainment and media space, you know, you're going to have some bumps and bruises in the near term future if you're, you know, looking to invest in an entertainment company, or if you're in the capital stack of one of the companies, whether it's a publicly traded company or a small company. And that, I think, you know, is going to continue kind of for the, you know, short term foreseeable future, as we are living in a COVID-19 world. I think sort of the positive or the opportunity in that note is if it's kind of something that you can go into that situation as, whether it's an investor in a peripheral industry that's related to media and entertainment, kind of with eyes wide open, there, you know, long term, there's a real opportunity for, you know, long term success once kind of the, again, I hate to say kind of once COVID-19 is behind us, because I know we may not live in the exact world that we lived in before COVID-19, but, you know, we're emerged from kind of whatever this being the new norm is. I think kind of a lot of those companies and people who make the right decisions and invest in the right decisions will do very well and be successful. And the fact of the matter is the demand for premium content and high quality content, whether that's a 2-hour film, a 5-minute short clip, a, you know, 47-minute serial television show, or a four-part, you know, mini documentary docuseries, the demand for that, it has never been higher and is going to continue to be higher. And again, just because someone may not be seeing that piece of content in a traditional brick and mortar movie theater or kind of watching it on a traditional network at 8 p.m. Pacific Standard Time like in the past, you know, doesn't mean there's not still a huge demand for that. So long term, you know, short term and near term, I think that there'll continue to be some challenges and difficulties, but long term, generally, I think we're going to be in a very good place.
Thank you, Chris. Listeners, you've been listening to Akin Gump Entertainment Partners Chris Spicer and Alissa Miller. As a cord cutter with multiple streaming subscriptions, I felt very seen. So thank you for making the time to explain just how this pandemic is affecting this industry that touches everyone's lives on a daily basis, either as participants in the work or as consumers of these terrific products. And thank you, listeners, as always, for your time and attention. Please make sure to subscribe to On Air with Akin Gump at your favorite podcast provider to ensure you do not miss an episode. We're on, among others, iTunes, YouTube, and Spotify. To learn more about Akin Gump and the firm's work in and thinking on media and entertainment matters, look for entertainment on the experience or the insights and news sections on AikinGump.com. Until next time. On Air with Akin Gump is presented by Akin Gump and cannot be copied or rebroadcast without consent. The information provided is intended for a general audience and is not legal advice or a substitute for the advice of competent counsel. Prior results do not guarantee a similar outcome. The content reflects the personal views and opinions of the participants. No attorney-client relationship is being created by this podcast, and all rights are reserved.